Good morning and welcome to our Sunday morning, August 30th, 2020 worship services with St. James Episcopal Church, located at 1020 West Lafayette Avenue on the west side of Baltimore, and the Church of St. Michael and All Angels, located at 2013 St. Paul Street on the east side of Baltimore. We welcome you into the presence of God this morning. Won't you join us with our opening hymn, The God of Abraham Praise, with our soloist, Brittany McNeil. Service leaflet, which you may find on YouTube or the church's website. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, craft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion. Nourish us with all goodness and bring forth in us the fruit of good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And then he said, come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 105. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing praises to him, and speak of his marvelous works.
Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Search for the Lord and his strength. Continually seek his face.
Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen.
Israel came into Egypt, and Jacob became a sojourner in the land of Ham.
The Lord made his people exceedingly fruitful. He made them stronger than their enemies.
whose heart he turned so that they hated his people and dealt unjustly with his servants.
He sent Moses his servant, and Aaron whom he had chosen.
Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from the book of Romans. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and on the third day be raised. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, if any want to become my followers, they must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. Those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose their soul? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Breathe on me, O breath of God, and fill my heart with life anew, that I may love whom thou dost love it, and do what thou wouldest do. In the name of Jesus I pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. In our Old Testament reading, you heard one of the greatest call stories ever. It was about a man who found himself on the backside of the mountain after living such a lavish life in Egypt. God calls him to come free his people from the clutches of Pharaoh and the Egyptians. It was as if God was calling him and imprisoning him that he might do the will of God, that he might stand before his judge, as you heard in this Old Testament reading, and make a decision that would impact the rest of his life. It's like the human court system. Before the judge pronounces sentence, when you've surrendered to the mercy of the court, they always ask you, did someone promise you anything in exchange for your plea deal? It is a way of pleading out your case or allowing the wheels of justice to turn without maximum pressure of a trial before your peers or a judge. After pleading guilty, you are then sentenced according to the guidelines under the law. At sentencing, the judge has the option of reducing the sentence, releasing you with the declaration you've already served time, and that's enough. He also may release you on probation or give you the maximum sentence allowed by law. In order to begin anew, put the past behind you, you have to pay some price, even if it's just the stress and strain of appearing before the judge. It's usually persons who are in this predicament that will either bargain their way out or make promises to avoid harsher sentencing. The crime itself and the potential sentencing cause one to rethink their actions, helps them realize it wasn't worth it. Sure, the profits of their action brought some kind of gain, wealth, or notoriety, but they now regret their actions. They've even said to themselves, I've gained the whole world, and in the process, I've lost my soul. We become prisoners of our own decisions. We deny the cross and hold conversations the rest of our lives, telling others, I sure missed my calling. If they had it to do over again, if they had it to make a new decision about, they'd do it much, much differently. They'd make a commitment. They'd follow the rules. They'd do differently, do things differently just to get another crack at avoiding the penalty. I use this analogy because it's not easy to commit to being a disciple. Jesus uses the example of one who puts off committing to the gospel for worldly fame or fortune. There is a cost for becoming a disciple, yet the reward is greater on earth and in heaven. The confusion comes when one would like to be a disciple, but change out the reward-cost ratio. They kind of manipulate it, try to figure it out. And once they figured it out, they have determined in their heart that it costs more to be a disciple than it does to live an ordinary, prosperous life. There is a huge differential, and you must never see the earthly benefit of discipleship. You may not ever see the earthly benefit of discipleship, but in the end, it comes to pass. Whoever loses their life for the sake of the gospel will find it, Jesus said. Jesus also said, those who give up their mother and father and sister and brother and earthly things will find on the other end of the bargain many more mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers here upon earth. There is a denial of one's life, of what would have been to reach the goal of what could be in Christ Jesus. This is a complicated process, but you never know what is going to happen until you do it. There are some of you who will actually have prosperous lives and will not be able to give up your life for the gospel. Who does that anymore? Gives 100% of themselves to God. So I'm talking to those of you on the fence who may be toying with the idea of being a true disciple. Those of you who may want to do more. I'm talking to those of you who are not satisfied with your life as it is. Those of you who know God is calling you to spend more time in the vineyard, helping others understand what this life is about. It's you that I'm talking to today. The text is clear when it says, if you want to be my followers, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. This is not easy. It is when they be there to deny and there be no cross. The denial means that you must contemplate giving up some of this world and its rudiments. Taking up the cross means that there is some burden that will be attached to you as you journey. Each of us has a different cross to bear. It could be just about anything, but you'll know it because the weight and the burden of it will cause you to buckle and think twice about what you've done. You'll know it instantly. It comes in the form of brokenness. It comes in the form of great loss. It comes in the form of suffering for the sake of Christ. It comes in the form of the cross being unbearable and often painful. It is not the norm, it is the exception. The cross has two pieces. One is horizontal and the other is vertical. The horizontal places the bearer would carry, and it is in the final stages that they'd be connected to the vertical. Life is horizontal, but death is vertical. As in life, so in death. In life and death, we ascend or descend. This horizontal piece was only one section of the hanging tree, as James Cone would call it. It was the ultimate price to pay. It was capital punishment. It was the death penalty of its day. They'd hang you in a public place as a demonstration of the power of the Roman government. You'd stay there in a public view. You'd stay there hanging in agony until the time came to break your bones. The breaking was so that you could no longer hold up the weight of your body and you'd finally suffocate, and cause of death would be suffocation. Death is sure on the cross. Oh God, why would I want to carry about this instrument of death in this body? If answering the call as a follower requires that I bear up a cross, why would I sell all and follow you? Lord, please give me one good reason. Following you, what's the benefit? What's in it for me? Why wouldn't I try to gain the world and avoid the cross? Why wouldn't I want to hold on to my wealth? Why wouldn't I want more of what I already have? Who told you to be a follower? Who told you to be a follower of Jesus Christ? Wouldn't cost you anything. Beloved, you are not the first to ponder this question. There are many examples in this text that prove this to be difficult. So I ask you again, who told you to be a follower of Jesus Christ would not cost you anything? It does cost you. It costs you your whole life. If you commit to the cause of Christ, you, however, lose nothing. You are the bearers of the good news. You are. Yes, you are. In today's troubled world, political, social, economic, post-racial, global and medical worlds, you must admit that there is trouble. The answer to trouble is we attest to the word of God, the word being totally sufficient for all things, salvation. And even when we need a word to make it through, there is where we lean on the word. The great part about being a disciple is once you have familiarized yourself with the word of God, you then know where to look for the words of encouragement, a message for this mess age. Some folk have needs far beyond the realm of possible. Some have needs far beyond the medical world. Some have needs that cannot be met socially, psychologically, or economically. As a matter of fact, their need just may be met in the word of God. What does that have to do with you? If you know the word, you can proclaim the word, and it is the power of God unto salvation if you're not ashamed of it. You, my brothers and sisters, God can use you if you avail yourself, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow Jesus. You may be the difference between life and death. Let it be known that the disciple has the words of eternal life. The psalmist said it this way, that the word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It can bring light to dark places. The conversations in the word today are full, in the world today are full of hopelessness and darkness and contempt and hatred and fear. And the word in you can bring light to the mind, light to the soul. More specific, you show forth the praises of him who brought you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You are the city on a hill that cannot be hid if you are a disciple. You are the light of the world if you are a disciple. You may not know it, but when you bring light to darkness, darkness covers its face and hides. The final point is, if not now, when? If you are to become a disciple, the time is now. Now is the time of salvation. There is time for everything under the sun, and now is the time for you to move. It is the time to say, yes, Lord, yes to your will, yes to your way. When you say yes, the Spirit of the Lord rests upon you, and you will find the power to preach the gospel, bring liberty to the captives, and bring sight to the blind. You will be able to commit, and in committing, you will find strength for your own soul. As time passes, it gets easier and easier to speak of your faith. It gets easier to pray. It gets easier to speak life into dead individuals. You will find that you were born for this, that this is your call to be a disciple. I love the passage from the book Grounded in God, one of the tools for discernment and group deliberations. The folks at Listening Hearts wrote, "To what is God call us? To what is God calling us as a group, or a people, or a church?" They take the parable of Jesus that says, the kingdom of heaven is like yeast, and that a woman took and mixed in 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. Meaning that your call and journey is not finished, is not a finished project. You are called, and as you journey, the reason that you said yes is revealed over time. Listening Hearts wrote, it is like clay to be molded. As you reflect on culture and leaven, the world and leaven, as you reflect on economy and leaven, the world's health, the pandemic and leaven, press your ministry, pound it, roll it, shape it, take it and feel it, stop, gaze, try it, experience it as prayer, as communication with God, Listening Heart says, and as being with God and being still to know that God is the potter and you are the clay. After you commit, cry out, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, and I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Take time right now to think about God's will for your life. Jesus said, for those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. And the Church of God said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Lord, we are so available to you. We now take the words of the Nicene Creed and affirm our faith and our availability. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The prayers of the people.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church that we all may
be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our bishops Eugene Sutton and Robert E. Law, our priest Richard Meadows, Father William Bill Fallfield, and our deacon Marshall Thompson, and all bishops and priests and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let life perpetual shine upon them.
Especially Angela Seaton, Gloria King, Catherine Ricks, Ron Cuffey.
Let life perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in the heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We pray for our families that are grieving. Rick's family, Ron Cuffey's family, the Seaton family, the King family. We pray, Lord, that you might have your will in their life. We pray for our government. We pray for our country. We pray for perpetrators of violence. We also pray for the peacemakers, for they shall see and know God.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
By what we have done, by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you of all your sins, and bring you into the righteousness of God through the power of the Holy Spirit, and may it keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. My brothers and sisters, now is the time when we exchange the peace. And in exchanging the peace, I'd like for you to look to your neighbor on your side, get on your telephone and call one of the members, text them, email them, and tell them, the peace of the Lord be always with you
and also with you.
It's time for our offertory, and we want to remind you that giving has continued in our churches, and we are so godly proud of the congregations, and we thank you for your generosity, even in this time of trouble. There's some of you are going far beyond what you would normally do and helping us in many different ways. We'd also like to thank those who contribute to the special ministries and the special days of our church as we continue forward in Christ. If you'd like to give to St. Michael's, you can do so by going to Cash App, $SMAA Church. You can give electronically that way or mail your offering directly to the church at 2013 St. Paul Street, Baltimore, Maryland. To St. James, you can send your money or your offering through pushpay.com. Connect with St. James Episcopal Church, Baltimore, or you can send yours directly to the church at 1020 West Lafayette Avenue, Baltimore, Maryland, 21217. So therefore, I beseech you, my brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, that you present yourselves as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, our offertory.
I'm
Dedicate this Eucharistic prayer to the memory of Lucille Liverpool, Angela Seaton, Ron Cuffey, Gloria King, and Catherine Ricks. Would you join us on page 361? The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts, lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, by his glorious resurrection opened the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, grant us thy peace. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We pray, O Lord, that those who receive this communion spiritually may receive it in the fullness of your mercy, that the blood of Jesus washes away all of our sins, and that his body was broken just for us. And it is now that we've been redeemed, that we've been set free, and that we are now the children of God through this sacrifice. This is our prayer. Join us on page 365 for our post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now unto him was able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Join us for our closing hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.